Journey to this podium for myself was really eventful, and I feel honored today to have the privilege to welcome all of you over here. A very good morning again to all of you, and let us go straight to the point. We are here today to understand the changing contours of women's paid and unpaid work. I was just having a brief discussion with our colleague Professor Meena Gopal 2 minutes back, and we were just exchanging our smiles and finally we tell you that our seniors are here, our contemporaries are here, our juniors and their juniors are here. And it's really a big moment for me to have this event today here and have this journey with Professor Vibhuti Patel for this last 1 year for the preparation for this conference here today. And this moment, I'm just feeling really emotional in a sense that Professor Vibhuti, with 40 years of experiences in women's work, and I am a nondescript person working with her for 1 year, to have all of you on board. Very, very warm welcome from both of us, from Institute and from Department, the School of Management and Labor Studies and School of Development Studies. Thank you very much. Professor Vibhuti Patel, can I request you, ma'am?
Shiva Raju and Dr. Professor Shashmita Palu, our friends from 8 countries abroad, our friends from India, teachers, dignitaries, executive committee members of Indian Association for Women's Studies, who gave a wholehearted support in the very beginning of this conference. Professor Vinu Paul, because of whom the whole process began. It was my first day of joining TISS. I was entering the gate and he was in his bicycle. He uses bicycle in Mumbai. And he said that, Professor Patel, you should do something. And in the afternoon, he sent Dr. Nandita Molder. And this is how we wanted a very small workshop on paid and unpaid work of women, which has been a very, very important concern of the women's movement right from the over last 100 years. The current year marks a century of women's suffrage movement, which began as a right to vote or women being treated as a citizen, but it also snowballed into deconstruction of housework and women who were getting into the larger social economy their concerns. The conversations on visible and invisible work, productive and unproductive work, unpaid care work, or work which gets unpaid care work which is non-monetized, has thrown light on nature of subordination of women, because we think it's our submission that economic independence is the minimum necessary, I emphasize, minimum necessary condition for dignity of women. Feminist economists have deconstructed care economy and also contribution of women in the mainstream of economic development, and they have pointed out ideological reference to trivialize productive and reproductive work of women through patriarchal control over women's sexuality, fertility, and labor. A famous joke in economics, in any economics student, in the very first lecture teacher says, if a man marries his cook, national income will reduce. As a cook, she gets wages, while as a wife, for absolutely the same thing, she won't get anything. And we had in the 70s wages for housework movement throughout Europe and Scandinavia. In fact, in Iceland, it was a 100% successful strike in which even president's wife was on strike. To highlight, they did not want the monetization of housework, but they said at least in the systems of national account, it should be considered. As this thing, there have been studies done by the feminist economist on the opportunity cost of care economy, as well as how care economy's ideology percolates into the mainstream economy, where women are at the bottom of the pyramid. Overarching concerns with respect to women's workforce participation in the 21st century have been changing labor processes. Recently, when it comes to South Asia, continuous declining work participation of women. In fact, ILO study, even the Indian World Economic Forum has lamented the fact that there has been reduction of 7 points in the work participation of women. In fact, the mainstream economists call it FEAR, F-E-A-R, female economic activity rate. labor employment relations and also labor standards, occupational health issues have been at the center stage of the concern. In fact, in the evening, we have a round table led by some of the luminaries, feminist economists. Professor Ritu Devan is already here, Professor Indira again, and they are going to discuss various aspects of how women are resisting this kind of subordination. Now, the only minuscule proportion of women in the world economy are in the organized sector with a better work condition, but the informalization, precariat labor force, which is facing backbreaking work, long hour of work, no dead-end work, which doesn't in any way give you any self-actualization, I think that has been the reality. It's a cliche to say that there is south in north and north in south, but it's a very important cliche. And this is not only, that's why we can say that it's not only in Africa, Latin America or Asia that women are at the receiving end of the capitalist system, but even in the developed countries, in the industrialized countries, women of color, they are at the bottom of the pyramid of the economy. Maria Mies, a German feminist, would rightly say that capitalist accumulation on a world scale rides on the back of cheapest labor of colored women, and she calls herself as the last colony. Women are the last colony of the 21st century economic globalization. Even in the sunrise industries, which is touted this thing by the mainstream economics journal, which talks about the information technology, business process outsourcing, knowledge process outsourcing, medical transcription, transliteration, these are supposed to be very, very rising industries, but that too, in the hierarchy of the industries, women are at the bottom. They don't have any chances of promotion. Couple of women CEOs in the financial sector or Fortune 500 companies, they are showcased as a symbol of empowerment of women, but large majority of professionally qualified women are stuck as middle of to the lower level and in the corporate sector. Presence of women in boardrooms across the industries worldwide is negligible. Apparently, they are better placed, but they don't get the level playing field. In fact, the current Me Too movement, which is the major slogan of Me Too movement, which came in the context of sexual harassment of so many women who are now high profile, and they say that more women in more powerful position, that is the only solution to sexual harassment of women, which World Bank has declared as the most devastating occupational hazard of 21st century women. Segmentation in the factor and product market. We have many women entrepreneurs also in this house, I think Vaikarna and many SHGs. There too, which we say that self-employed women, they also don't get a better level playing field in the factor market as well as product market because of the lack of backward and forward linkage, and markets being socially constructed. Markets are also segmented on the line of caste, class and gender. So masculinity of capital is inclined towards investing resources only in the quote-unquote old boys club, which operates on a race, caste and class and religious identities. So in spite of such adversities, what we have seen, this is not only a soft story, but there is also a story, there are rays of hope. Networks like Women Working Worldwide, HomeNet, Committee of Asian Women, TAO, rural and urban working class women's organizations, Gabriella Women Farmers Organization in Philippines, Green Belt Movement in Africa, Domestic Workers Union in several countries across the world, women's cooperatives in right in Mumbai, Sri Mukti Sangatna, Annapurna Mahila Mandal, women trade units like Self-Employed Women's Union, and also women's banks like Mandesh Mahila Sarkari Mandi, they have done the handholding. The new solidarities have emerged among the women from the marginalized section and also working women. Three approaches in the women's studies, women in development, women and development, and gender and development, they all are talking about challenging patriarchy in a different way, and many experiments at a level of praxis have been made. How to survive in a neoliberal and neoconservative economic system has been a mind-boggling issue confronting labor economists, trade unionists, development thinkers, gender studies scholars, and international labor organization. We are lucky to have been representatives from there. Now, it is in this context, global context, where the School of Management and Labor Studies and School of Development Studies decided to join hands, and we decided the thematic areas and objectives of this conference basically to deliberate upon bringing people from varied experiences who are working with, whether they are in public sector, private sector, in different locations, different geographies, come together and deliberate upon the issues facing and the new challenges faced by women in organized and unorganized sector. To identify the varied forms of strategies and tactics evolved by different community organizations or people's organizations to challenge the exploitative order, and to critically evaluate various theories of labor studies to search for a gender responsive and gender inclusive answers. So we are happy to receive 77 papers which have been accepted after scrutiny by our editorial team. I would like to place on record and appreciate President of Indian Association for Women's Studies, Dr. Meera Velarji. Hers was the first paper in full paper, not abstract. And imagine she's a very busy person. She's a leader by example. And please join your hands. And the thematic areas covered by the 77 papers are in the women in the corporate world, women as workers, as staff, at management cadre, women in different professional careers, women in urban and rural informal sector, women in agriculture and allied activities, women in public sector undertakings, women in education sector, and women in also both conventional and modern service sector, hospitality, about which we are saying after globalization, we say that the women's inclusion in service sector has increased globally, whether it is hospitality or transport or care economy. Women's cooperatives, women in sunrise industries, women in financial sector, women in administrative and governance, and also women's work and response of the state in terms of legislature, in terms of new rules and structures of the governance. Now, women all around the world have been doing paid, underpaid, and largely unpaid work as in homes, factories, fields, forests, and mines. Even in this Millennium Development Goal, even in Sustainable Development Goal, it has been accepted that 2/3 of the world's work is done by women, but what women get in return is 1/10 of world's income, and women own only 1% of world's property. So that shows you that in the structure of this pyramid of economy, where are women? Now, if women don't, the kind of work which women do to sustain the household, to augment the family resources in terms of collection of fuel, fodder, water, livestock raising, kitchen gardening, and that is not part of the systems of national account. And and if women did not do this kind of work, the same services had to be purchased from the market. So continuous non-recognition of contribution of women's paid and unpaid work creates a deep wound and results in low self-esteem among women who start believing in the nothingness of her existence, even in her labor. And her professional contribution matters in progression of family, community, and state, but still it remains invisibilized. Here it is important to note that women's labor is not merely a form of instrumental action. It is essentially a mode of social interaction in which she seeks and deserves mutual recognition. I'm borrowing the quote from Nandita's writing. The collection of abstracts from the International Conference of these changing contours of women's paid and unpaid labor are depicting the epitome of evidences across the world where time and again voices are raised to ask for the dignity of labor of women, and we end with saying that women hold up half the sky. I would like to end with the words of my favorite poet, is Maya Angelou, Women Work. I have got children to tend, the clothes to mend, the floor to mop, food to shop, then the chicken to fry, baby to dry, body to dry. I got company to feed, garden to weed. I have got shirts to press, the tots to dress, the cane to be cut. She's an agricultural worker working in a cane farming and cotton farming. I have got to clean up this hut, this see about and then see about the sick and the cotton to pick. Shine on me, sunshine, rain on me, rain. Fall softly, dew drops, and cool my brow again. Storm, blow me from here with your fiercest wind. Let me float across the sky till I can rest again. Sun, rain, sky, mountain, oceans, leaf and stone, star shine, moon glow, you are all that I can call my own. She doesn't have anybody, family, state, community, or global citizens. Let us take a pledge that we will be holding hands of women, working women in all sectors of the economy, and strengthen the frontiers of solidarity across the marginalities.
Good morning, everyone. Now I request Professor Shalini Bharat to come and chair the session. I would like to give a small introduction of the chairperson, Professor Shalini Bharat. Professor Shalini Bharat is acting director and professor in the School of Health System Studies, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. She is also the program director of Stiftung Foundation, the global fund supported initiative which implements the TB-HIV counseling program in Mumbai in collaboration with the Mumbai District TB Control Society. She was the first dean of the restructured School of Health System Studies and served in that capacity from March 2006 to August 2008. Prior to that, she was head of the research unit for family studies. She also serves on the scientific advisory committees and technical review groups of many national and international organizations and research. We welcome you, ma'am, on the dais. Thank
Professor Vibhuti Patel. Professor Sivaraju, Deputy Director, Professor Sasmita Palu, colleagues from the Institute, all the dignitaries from near and far, a very, very warm good morning and a very warm welcome to the city of Mumbai and to the Institute and of course to this conference. I am acutely aware of the fact that I am among giants and stalwarts, and I don't think I am going to be delivering a presidential address of a stature which will do justice to this conference. Just as she was reading out my brief introduction, I was made aware of the fact that before I was working in the field of health, I also did a little bit of work in the family studies field, and that's where I engaged with the entire theme of women work and life work balance. And I was remembering the time that I really looked at very closely at women in organized workforce, but was made aware of the fact that a large sector of women are in the unorganized workforce, and this conference I think is really apt for me to be in. But Professor Vibhuti Patel asked me to, I think, just welcome and inaugurate, and that's what I'm going to really do. But a few words which she has already introduced the theme of the conference in a way. I'm just going to take a few points. So the overarching concerns with respect to women and workforce participation of women in the 21st century have been the changing labor processes, labor employment relations, and labor standards in different sectors of the economy. It is a disturbing fact, and I think we all are made aware of it, that only a minuscule proportion of women in the world economy is in the organized sector, with relatively better standards of social security and social protection. The rest of the women worldwide face oppressive working conditions, long working hours with little remuneration, and even with little prospects of upward social and economic mobility. Paradoxically, as Professor Vibhuti Patel also said, there is south in the north and north in the south. There is ample evidence from research across to show that not only in Africa, Latin America and Asia, that women workforce in the developed, so-called developed and industrialized world also face the same predicament as footloose workers in the informal economy. And in the poverty group, the world over, self-employed women end up self-exploiting themselves as the returns for their hard work are quite low. We've also heard from Professor Patel that February 6, 2018 marked a century of women's suffrage, for which the first generation of women's rights activists
fought relentlessly, making great personal sacrifice in the face of tremendous patriarchal resistance. Though this movement began with striving for other franchisee for women as a fundamental rights, right as a citizen, it snowballed into struggle for rights of the women as paid and unpaid workers. And during this last century, in spite of sustained collective actions in several parts of the North and the South, discrimination against women in the world of work still persists due to caste, race, ethnicity, sexuality, gender-based segmentation in the labor market and non-recognition of unpaid care economy. The struggle of working women has gradually gained focus while the entire world of work has been going through a sea change. Informality made an inroad across world when women in formal world of work find themselves thronging at the periphery. And they have remained at the periphery in many, many parts of the world. The labor power of women stands amidst contestation. Of late, this landscape of job market pushed them into more uncertainty while the safety net is being withdrawn gradually. And this we are seeing in, you know, so-called rising economies as well. So the women are really not the beneficiaries and never going to be the beneficiaries if the same mindset and the same patriarchal setup continues. The boundaries are being often blurred when a woman enters the job market. Her productive and reproductive roles are always being pitched against each other to rattle the very foundation of her status as a labor. The recent agrarian crisis fueled by neoliberal macroeconomic policies coupled with exponential growth propelled by technology forced the women workforce witness an overarching unsettling future. I think it is this kind of a movement and this kind of an unsettling situation we are seeing everywhere that this particular conference assumes critical importance. And I'm looking at the kind of objectives that have been laid out for this conference, which of course is known to you in the conference document as well, which is to deliberate upon the issues and experiences of women across organized and unorganized sector, to excavate the contours that women are struggling to create as their own in the contemporary world, to identify the varied forms of strategies and tactics evolved by women to meet the challenges thrown up by the neoliberal ecosystem, and to critically evaluate various theories of labor studies to search for a gender-responsive answer. I'm told there are over 70 papers received, and the kind of topics and sub-themes that have been taken up indeed give a very wide spectrum of the problem. I'm looking at women in corporate as workers, women in professions, down to the whole idea of how we look at women in unpaid workforce, unpaid economy. This particular conference, I'm told, is attended by 70 or maybe 40 people from 40 countries, both near and far, academic scholars, also students, and I'm very happy to see the room full, especially when students are also made part of a conference like this. I would like to therefore welcome you all again and declare this conference open. I hope you have a very productive 2 days of this conference. Welcome once again.
This is Asmita Palo to come on the dais and talk about School of Management and Labor Studies.
Good morning, everyone. Professor Bharat, Professor Singhraj, Professor Patel, all my esteemed colleagues who are present over here, my the invited guests, the participants, and the students who are being present here and who are volunteering the entire show. In fact, this conference is a long-cherished dream of the School of Management. In the past, some of scholars, some of my colleagues in the center of in the school who are working in the field of gender and diversity management at the workplace, on several occasions we discussed about how to conduct a, to have a conference on gender-related issues. But our initial idea was always been restricted to the organized sector, to the corporate sector, because we from the management, our focus is usually the corporate sector. So, but we discussed a lot, but our discussion has never culminated into any action. I genuinely thank Professor Patel and Dr. Nandita Mandal, who really came up with this idea of putting everything together, that is the organized sector, the unorganized sector, the paid work, the unpaid work, everything together, and to conduct this, to organize this conference. My profound thanks to both of you, really hats off to you. I would personally like to thank Dr. Christoph Sarat, who has suggested us that you should not confine it to the national level conference, but you should take it up to the international level. So that is how this international conference on the changing culture has come into the picture. We have invited the participants, we have invited the students, researchers from diverse groups, as Professor Patel has spoken about in the beginning, and also it was being reiterated by Professor Bharat. We have representatives from the government, we have representatives from NGOs, from the administration, from the corporate sector. We have the academicians, very renowned academicians who are present over here. The scholars who have worked extensively in the field. We have also representatives from the unorganized group, like the scavengers group, who are going to present their case maybe either today or. So we have organized a number of panel discussions, very interesting panel discussions. We have organized a number of, there are different panel, the paper presentations. I'm sure in these 2 days we are going to have a very invigorating kind of discussion about the issue which you have taken now. Just a brief about the School of Management, which is one of the hosts of this conference. Our school has been in existence in TISS for more than 5 decades. This is our 55th year of existence. We started with in 64 with the PMIRD, then PMIR, Personal Management Industry Relations, which is of course an offshoot of the social work program, which is the one of the most flagship program in TISS. And over the last 5 decades, we have evolved to a different scale. Right now, we have around 4 centers in the school: the Center for Human Resource Management, the Center for Globalization Labor Studies, then we have the Center for Social Entrepreneurship, then we have a center, the Center for Social and Organizational Leadership. So accordingly, we are offering 4 master's programs. So 237 master students who are right now pursuing their master's program in our school. In addition to that, we have also integrated entry PhD program, and there are 24 students who are currently pursuing MPhil program in the school, and there are more than 50 PhD students who are working on varied topics with different faculties in the school. So though if you look at the programs in details, the program which are the anchors from the School of Management, the nature of the program, the kind of the mission and vision of all the programs are so different, but though they are so different, but at the end of the day we are so aligned to each other. And we are so aligned with the overarching purpose, the overarching mission and vision of TISS. That is how we can produce the socially conscious, socially relevant, and high professional group of students who can really serve the needs of the society. That is the purpose of all the programs we are offering from this school. So this is a brief about this school, so I will not waste a lot of time of yours. With this, I welcome you to this 2 days conference. Please take advantage of the 2 days stay over here and enjoy the monsoon in Bombay also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sasmita Palu.
Bharat for giving a detailed overview about School of Management and Labor Studies, one of the most established schools in Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Now I would request Professor Shivaraju to come and give an overview about the School of Development Studies.
Good morning, everybody. At the outset, I invite all of you for this important international event. Though I am now located in Hyderabad, but the current Dean, Professor Ritambara, has asked me to represent this school. Of course, school as I am part of this school. So I invite all of you because my senior colleague, Professor Bibhuti Patel, who is leading this important event, I don't think any introduction for her on behalf of this school, but I have to mention that it became a very important shift after her arrival. I am seeing the quiet visibility of the vibrant way of the activities. For instance, this important international event itself signifies her presence in the institute. So though I know during the last 10-15 years my association with her in SNDT and other universities, but here we have the privilege of that association. Let me briefly introduce the School of Development Studies, where Advanced Center for Women's Studies is located. It started in 2006, I think, when we part of our restructuring. At that time, this was a Center for Development Studies, which was located in School of Social Sciences. So, and then at that time itself, the Center for Development Studies was one of the major, largest centers in the institute. We were more than 15 faculty located in one particular center. That itself signifies the importance of development studies. In the sense, the development studies being a multidisciplinary, it requires multidimensional aspects of studies, and it encompasses various issues. That is where the development studies is an important role to play. To that extent, being a multidisciplinary, the faculty also bringing from their own respective field of expertise, plus coming together gives a lot of liberty and flexibility to work in a cohesively in a team. So this school, subsequently in 2012, the center became a School of Development Studies, and one of the major shift was bringing an Advanced Center for Women's Studies. That was one of the major strength of this school, because you know very well that when we talk about women's issues, it cut across different dimensions of development. So to that extent, there is a very cohesiveness when we say that this School of Development Studies, where the Advanced Center for Women's Studies is also part of this. Besides this center, Advanced Center for Women's Studies, the school also has five more centers, like a Center for Developing Economies, Center for Developing Societies, Center for Population Health and Development, Center for Social Theory, Center for Public Policy, Habitat and Human Development. And I'm very happy to share with you that it is one of the largest still among the schools, if I am correct, and it gives a multi perspectives when we talk about this developmental issues. This school has at MA level, both MA in Women's Studies, MA in Development Studies, MPhil in Women's Studies, MPhil in Development Studies, and also PhD in different social science aspects with a special focus on developmental issues. And these faculty, coming from different multidisciplinary teams, they bring a lot of richness in bringing the issues and deliberating on developmental aspects. Coming back to this important topic for today, where we all gathered, I think it is a very significant step of having a collaboration between School of Management and Labor Studies, where Dr. Nandita is representing. She is also not new for us. For most of us, we were closely associated. In fact, we have furthermore association, because she represents in different academic programs with us, and Professor Bibhuti Patel, and taking up this important topic of paid and unpaid work, which requires a lot of expertise of bringing different disciplines and critically analyze the issues that comes around this aspect. I wish you all the best. I am sure that the respective field in which you are going to touch upon this core issue of work, especially for women. And I only conclude by just mentioning, because I moved in the field of gerontology, where elderly issues are made. So whenever we talk about feminization of aging, you know very well that aging issues are tilting towards women's issues, in terms of not only in terms of the number, but also in terms of the vulnerability and the isolation in which they are located. So when we are talking about their well-being and their quality of life, they are the most vulnerable. So I hope some of the aspects which you are going to touch upon, by request to see how the elderly women, when we talk about their work and their paid or unpaid aspects, are we are going to deliberate, that will signify an important aspect. You know, in one of the field work when I was doing in slums in Mumbai, I just say that I had a very detailed discussion with one of the elderly women responding. It took for half an hour for me to take permission from the young members to take approval from them to interview this lady. She is around 70 plus. You know, first aspect is young members, a lot of resistance. She is outdated. Why you want to interview her, or why you are wasting your time? So these are the ageism and related issues. In spite of that, when I sat for 45 minutes to 1 hour, at the end of the day, when I was coming out, most of the young members are all laughing. Professor, you have wasted your time. So what she might have told you. But when I came out, she called me again in front of all the members. She said that first time for 45 minutes to 1 hour, you have interviewed me and you have noted some of my life situation. Whether whatever benefit it comes or not, I don't know through this your survey. But at that time, I may not be available or I may not be alive. But please note down all these young members who have to get that benefit. My point is, what you call, whether it is a paid or unpaid work, her heart, which lies for the well-being of the family, is very important. That I don't think we can measure whether from economic side. So those aspects which describes the non-monetary side, especially which women contribute. Okay, so that I think one of the aspects. I leave it to all of you, because you are the learned people who have already have a lot of involvement and expertise in the field. I wish you all the best, and it's a very significant for School of Development Studies, because with collaboration with Management Studies, this will be paved the way for showcasing how the women's issues, furthermore from developmental perspective, how best we can, and furthermore adding with the management point of view and labor studies point of view, we can bring it out. I am sure Professor Vibhuti Patel and Dr. Nandita are going to bring out very important international contributions in a book form or report form, which will help all of us to take it further. Thanks a lot. All the best.
Like Mr. Vaibhav Raj, Dr. Meela Vilayatin, and Ms. Anjali Bedekar and Nandita to join us.